Wonderful.
So there are three levels which by which one can fulfill the rabbinic law to light the menorah on Chanukah. The sages enacted three levels of observance. This is quite unusual. We don't have mitzvahs that have, other mitzvahs usually have two levels, basic and enhanced. When it comes to the menorah, as you know, there are three levels. Basic, mahadrin, enhanced, level one. Mahadrin, minim mahadrin, enhanced, within the enhanced. What are the three levels? So the first level to observe the mitzvah of lighting the menorah as enacted by the sages in the year following the story of Chanukah. So the first level is one candle per night, per household. End of story. Second level is one candle per adult, per household, every night. Third level is the famous dispute between the school of Shamai and the school of Hillel. Beis Hillel says, level three, which is enhanced within the enhanced, mahadrin mina mahadrin, so what do? You light one candle the first night, two candles the second night, or two flames, three, and so on till the end of Chanukah. According to Shammai, it's the reverse. How do you observe level three? You light eight the first night, seven the second night, six the third night, and the final night, the eighth night, one candle. All right, so these are the three levels of observance, and we have just noted that in level number three, there are two views, the school of Shammai and the school of Hillel, Beis Shammai and Beis Hillel. So again, to repeat them quickly, because we've got to get this perfectly clear, this is not the complex part. Level one is one candle per household, no matter how many people there are. It's one candle, one flame every night, and that's it. No difference between the first night or the eighth night, or any nights in the interim. That's the basic level. So if you have only, you know, eight candles, that's all you possess, then fine, you can fulfill the mitzvah. You're on a desert island and you only have eight candles and you have a box of matches. So you light one each night and you fulfill the mitzvah, you make a bracha. The second view is you want to enhance. If there's more than one adult, you light one candle for each person, will light his candle each night. And the third view is the two views we mentioned, Shammai and Hillel. Now, whether you start with eight, go down to one, or start with one and go up to eight. Now the Gemara says, there's an argument amongst the latter sages, the Amaroyim, in explaining the views of Shammai and Hillel. What's the reason for the views, the respective views of Shammai and Hillel? Why does Hillel hold you start with one and you go to eight? Why does Shammai hold you start with eight and you go down to one? So within their two views, there are two opinions to explain their views. And we'll see, it's not just two opinions explaining their reasoning, but we'll see that these different opinions in explaining their reasoning, their rationale, there's a practical halachic differences as well, as we will demonstrate. But first now, the two sages, the latter sages, each one offers different explanations explaining Shammai and Hillel. And that is as follows. One says like this. The reason of Beis Shammai, who says you start with eight and you go down to one, because Shammai says you count the days that are coming. So the first night, eight nights are coming, eight candles. The second night, the 7 days ahead, you light seven. 7 days ahead, including the night that we're on right now. And so it diminishes as less and less days are coming. And the last night, it's one night, one candle. The view of Beis Hillel says this view. This is one explanation in explaining the two views. Beis Hillel says that you light corresponding to the days that have elapsed. Not that are coming, but that have gone. So the first night, it's one and it's leaving, one candle. The second night, we've got two in the bag. Three, we count the days that are passing, not the days that are coming. That's one view in explaining the divergent, the argument between Shammai and Hillel. Another sage has a whole different rationale and says, why Rabbi Shammai say that you start with eight and you go down to one? Because he says we should follow the pattern of the way the sacrifices were brought on Sukkot. The sacrifices as outlined in the Torah, the oxen, they were brought on Sukkot. So the Torah says on the first day of Sukkot you bring 13 and then you diminish every single day. So that in the seventh day of Sukkot you bring 7, it's a total of 70. 13 plus 12 plus 11 and so on all the way down to the seventh day is 70. The point is you bring one less every night, every day in the temple. Every day in the temple. So too, our menorah should follow this pattern. Diminishing. In the words of the sage, connected Poreya Hachag, corresponding to the oxen that were brought for the 7 days of the Yom Tov of Sukkot. It's a very different rationale than the other sage who said, you light according to the days that are to come. No, it has to do with following the model of the diminishing sacrifices on Sukkot. The second view continues in explaining the school of Hillel. And he said, it's not because you light the days that have elapsed. No, another consideration. Why do we increase every night? Not because one day, we now have 2 days, now we have 3 days, 4 days. No, that was the other opinion. This is a different opinion. What's the reason? Because when it comes to matters of holiness, you should always increase. Ma'alin ba'kodesh, ve'ein moridin. We increase, we don't decrease. Therefore, the first night one, second night two, third night three, and so on. So what are we left with right now? And this is not yet the analytical part. But I hope we're clear, because we're going to be building on this, friends. All right? What we are doing now is we just shared with you two opinions in the Gemara, in the Talmud, offering each one different rationales to explain the schools, the respective schools of Shammai and Hillel. In summary, fact, Shammai says you go 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Hillel says you go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. You increase. What's the reason for these two views? So we have two opinions offering two sets of explanations, one for each. One view says they're arguing whether you light according to the days that are coming or the days that are going. The second view, that's Shammai and Hillel. Shammai says according to days that are yet to come. Hillel says the days that have elapsed. That's their argument. That's the reason for their two views. Another school says, no, it's something else entirely. Shammai says you decrease following the pattern of the decreasing sacrifices on Sukkot. And Hillel says you increase because when it comes to matters of holiness, one should always increase. Are we clear so far? This is just the basis. Now we're going to get a little analytical. And that is as follows. We're going to go successive levels of detail and complexity. Number one, the argument, the different explanations offered by the latter, by the sages of the Gemara, who are offering different explanations for the opinions of Shammai and Hillel, they're not just offering different rationales, but the different rationales also will bring to a practical difference. In other words, what difference does it make what their reasoning is? Shammai says you decrease, Hillel says you increase. No, it makes a difference if you know why. There's a practical difference. And what's the practical difference? Let's put this aside for a second. We'll revisit it in a minute. We started off the class by telling you there are three levels of observance that the sages enacted by which one discharges one's obligation to light the menorah. You got a choice. You can do level one, level two, or level three. Level three, there are two opinions. Which way you do it, all right? The question is like this. You recall, level one was one candle per night per household. Level two was one candle per night per household per adult. So if there's 10 people in the house over bar mitzvah, bat mitzvah, the second few says you light 10 candles each night. The first few says it's one candle each night, even if there's 1,000 people in your house. The third view, we said, was Mahadrin, Bina Mahadrin, and the two views of Shammai and Hillel. The obvious question is, does the third view, is it building on the second view? The second view already introduced that each person should light his own singular candle. Is the third view now saying that each person should either light 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, or at Shammai, or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, Hillel? Each person? Or is the third view built only on the first opinion? The first, not opinion, first level. I use the word view, it shouldn't be used view. Level. Is the third level building on level two? Or is the third level building on level one? When level one said one candle per night, and the second level is one candle per night per adult, and the third view is the two opinions of Shammai. The third level is the two opinions of Shammai and Hillel. Are they building on level one or level two? That's what the bottom line is. If you want to do level three, is it for each person in the household or only for one per household? That's the question in the code of Jewish law. The codifiers debate whether someone who chooses to do level three, what does it mean? Is it per household? Only building on level one, or is it each adult does level three, either according to Shammai or Hillel? Of course, the ruling is always like Hillel. So this is, in fact, an argument between the Rambam, Maimonides, and Tosfos. Rambam says every person of the household should, let's just stick with Hillel, because that's the ruling. Every person, every adult in the household should have his menorah where you increase every night. Shammai would say you decrease, Hillel says you increase, but it's every person. And Tosfos says no, level three is connected with level one. It doesn't build on level two. Now, what's the basis of this argument between the Rambam and Tosfos? It's really which reason are you going to accept as the reasoning for the schools of Shammai and Hillel? Let's go through it logically. If the point is to increase in holiness or let's take the first view. If the explanation is to mark the days, they argue which way you mark the days. You mark it by increasing, you mark it by decreasing. So then, if that's the whole point, then it would make sense that the third view says it's only per household. Because when you walk into the house, then you'll see. What's the point of the third level? To mark the number of days, either increasing or decreasing. But you mark the number of days. So the Tosfos holds that how many do you light? Does each adult member light? No. To achieve the objective of the third view, which is to mark the days, it's enough to have one menorah per household. So that's the opinion of Tosfos, who says that the third view is not built on the second. It's only built on the first. Instead of lighting one candle a night, you mark the days, Shammai way or Hillel way. But it's only per household, because the goal is being achieved. You want to mark, you should look at the menorah, know right away which night of Hanukkah it is. But according to the second view that says, nothing to do with that. The consideration here is not to mark the number of days, either increase or decrease. It's a separate consideration. Whether we follow the model of Sukkot, or whether, that's Shammai, decrease, or whether we follow the mandate, the general mandate to increase in holiness. If it's a matter of increasing in holiness, then why shouldn't each person increase in holiness? According to Hillel, or according to Shammai, follow the model of Sukkot. So each person would light his menorah, like Hillel going up, or like Shammai going down, but it should be each person. Clear? So what have we pointed out now? We pointed out, hope you're following this, that the two opinions in offering the rationale for Shammai and Hillel, there's a practical difference. Which rationale you will choose? If the rationale is to indicate the number of days, that's the whole point, then one menorah per household, goal achieved. If the rationale is you increase in holiness, Hillel, Shammai, you follow the model of Sukkot, you diminish like the oxen diminished, then each person should do that accordingly. It isn't about what number of days, it's about me growing or diminishing, following the model of the cow, of the oxen on Sukkot according to Shammai. So that's the practical difference. So what, in summary, there's a dispute amongst the codifiers. Does the third level mean for each person it's only per household? Tosfos says it's only per household. Maimonides says it's for each person. Why are they arguing? Because each one is choosing a different rationale which the Talmud offers. Based on the two rationales, you have two different conclusions. Clear? Now we're going to get even more complex, more interesting. What's more interesting is that what's the final ruling amongst the codifiers? The ruling is that it's per household. I'm sorry, per individual. If you want to do level three, which everybody does, so how do you do it? Each adult has his own menorah. That's the final ruling. Now, even accepting this as that's the bottom line, no more discussion. We follow the rule of the Rambam, which is brought down in the Code of Jewish Law, that what? That each adult member, if you want to do level three, it's each adult will light the menorah. According to Hillel, increasing, that's the final ruling. There's still a difference as to what the rationale is. Here's two scenarios where the rationales that the Gemara offered become very relevant, even if we're in the final ruling that it's per each individual. And what's the case? The case is as follows. This is a beautiful Talmudic analysis. Relentless logic, my friends. You're getting a taste of yeshiva learning. If it's making you a little bit dizzy, that's good. That's what happens in yeshiva. You got to break your head. That's the expression we use. It's a brech in the cup. Toil. All right, so here we go. What happens in a case where, for whatever reason, somebody on the second night only lit one candle? Because he didn't have two candles to light. He only had one. So now comes the question, what do I do now the next night? The next night is now night number three. What should I do? So according to the opinion that says the whole level three is to mark the days that a person, for example, will come into the house and know right away what night of Hanukkah it is, because you can see the number of candles. Either way that you go, Shammai or Hillel. If the case is in point here, that the second night you only lit one candle, then and the whole point is to show the number of days, then even though last night I did one candle, night's the third night, I should light three candles. That's for sure. No question about it. If I get my new box of candles, you light three. Last night you lit one, you should have lit two. Now you're going to light three. That was that without saying. It's obvious because that's going to show you what tonight is. You're marking the time. But according to the other opinion, they said it isn't about marking the time, it's about increasing. It's about increasing or it's about decreasing. So therefore, if last night I lit one, it's enough for me to light only two, because thereby I fulfill my increase, even if though it's irrespective, because this view says it's got nothing to do with marking how many nights. It's a matter of growing in Yiddishkeit. So last night I lit one, I should have lit two, but I lit one. Tonight I'll light two. It's a practical difference. Again, in a case where in the second night the person only lit one because he didn't have, do you light three on the third night or do you light two? If it's about marking the time, you'll light three. Let's stick with Hillel because it's simpler. And if it's about increasing, then I have to add one. Because the consideration is not marking the time, not looking at the menorah and seeing what night it is. The other view says it's just about increasing in holiness. Am I increasing? I am increasing. Because last night I lit one, tonight I light two. And here's another practical difference. It's the third night of Chanukah. And I ran out of oil. And I only have enough to light two. Or only have two candles. Whatever, it's the third night of Chanukah. And I only have two. Should I light them or not? If it's a question of what? Since you can't mark the time anyway, then it's enough to light just one. Because you're not going to be anyway marking the... It's the third night, you only have two candles. You're not going to be indicating which night it is. So fulfill the basic mitzvah, light one. But if the consideration is increasing in holiness, then even tonight is light three, night three, light two. At least you're not going down. At least you're increasing to respect Hillel's view. All right, now it goes even more complex, but I think we'll stop here in terms of our analysis. And let's get into some spiritual insight, which I know you're all waiting for. You want to get the Hasidus. Let me just tell you what we just did now. So just to put it all in, you know, we're not going to repeating the whole discussion again. Just give you the outline. We identified three levels of observing. We pointed out in level three, there are two opinions, Shammai and Hillel. We pointed out that within Shammai and Hillel, there are two opinions as to what the rationale is. And then we explained three practical differences based on a different rationale within Hillel or Shammai. Three scenarios where there be three different conclusions based on what rationale we will accept as the rationale between Shammai and Hillel's ruling. That's what we just did now. Truth is, this kind of class really needs a flowchart, needs a blackboard or a whiteboard. Or maybe I should have held up a chart to show you. It would have been easier to follow. But anyway, even if you didn't follow fully all of the aforementioned, you will follow what follows now. I'm going to share with you now a third rationale, independent, not really, but at least superficially independent of the other rationales we just offered in explaining Shammai and Hillel. A more essential rationale. They come from two very different perspectives. What are the different perspectives? The perspectives are, the debate here is potential versus actual. Potential versus actual. Let's spell it out. It's now the first night of Chanukah. How many potential days of Chanukah lie before us? Eight. How many actual nights do we have on the first night, for example? One. Now go to the second night. The second night of Chanukah. How many potential days stretch before us on the second night? Seven. How many actual days have elapsed? Two. So now you see the difference, another deeper explanation and explaining the rationale of Shammai. Shammai says, we look at the potential. The potential is diminishing as Chanukah is actualized night after night. According to Hillel, we look at the tangible. How many days have I lived through? Tonight's one night, second night, third night. So the candles reflect the actualized days. The argument is a very deep argument. This potential and actual. The root of it really is, I'll get to cut to the chase here. The root of it is, what do we mean by potential and actual? Potential means, at its core and its root, potential means the divine creative force that is the force behind everything, by which God brings existence into existence. Actual means the actual manifested creation. Potential means the energy the pristine initial energy that is the source of the particular creation. The divine energy that's the potential that when manifested will produce a particular creation. As you just heard, Shammai says, we look at potential. Hillel says, we view the actual. What's their argument? To explain this a little bit deeper, here's another argument between the two, and they're consistent in their views. They're arguing, what was created first, heaven or earth? Shammai says, first heaven, then earth. Hillel says, first earth, and then heaven. Now the question is, how could they even be arguing? The Torah makes it very clear. The opening verse, in the beginning God created heaven and earth. So what's their argument? Their argument is, friends, here we get to the bottom line, what is the purpose of our existence? Is the purpose of our existence to bring heaven down to earth or to elevate earth to heaven? Which direction are we going? Is it about suffusing, engaging, permeating, bringing holiness into the world? Or the opposite, it's about surrendering, dissolving, and transcending, ascending to the divine source. You can hear the different language here. Let me just use my hands, watch my hands. Is it about this, or is it about this? Is it about bringing heaven down to earth, that the heaven, the transcendent, the potential, should suffuse and be manifested in the actual? Is it about sanctifying the world? Or is it about the opposite? It's about surrendering the world, dissolving the world, and ascending to uniting with transcendence. Are we going towards heaven? Is it the earth, worldliness, materiality, ascending level by level to heaven? Or is it the opposite? It's about heaven coming down level by level to earth. That's the root of the argument of Shammai and Hillel. Shammai says the objective of life is to transcend it. He looks at the potential. That's the reality. That's the objective. Heaven comes first. He means the objective is God created this physical world that we should dissolve it through mitzvahs, through surrender, through sacrifice, and ascend to a transcendent spiritual plane. And Hillel says the opposite's the purpose. It's about suffusing the material, the physical, with the divine. In other words, here's 2 days of the year. Which one of them is the quintessential Jewish moment, the objective? Purim or Yom HaKippurim? Which one becomes the model for everything, for all of life? According to Shammai, it's Yom HaKippurim. A day of transcendence, disengagement, fasting, angelic. We're here in this world to overcome it, to transcend it. So for Shammai Yom Kippur, Yom HaKippurim would be the quintessential Jewish moment. And for Hillel, it would be Purim, the opposite. Food, drink, engaging in the world, suffusing it with holiness. Is fasting the quintessential moment? Or eating in a godly way the quintessential moment? Is it surrender? Is that what it's about? Or is it about suffusing, engaging? Is it transcendence or immanence? Are we going towards heaven, or are we bringing heaven towards earth? Now, time doesn't permit us to explain. It's both simultaneously. That's very, very deep. But let's understand these two divergent views as manifested in their dispute about the menorah, which they, the same discussions about many areas in Jewish law and life. Which direction are we going? Shammai says, we are working towards the source. We're ascending. That's what potential means. So we view Chanukah from the potential lens. And Hillel says we view Chanukah from the realized actual lens. Shammai says we're getting less and less and less candles. Hillel is, we're increasing. Shammai says we have to diminish, dissolve the ego. Hillel says engage the ego more and more. Hillel, less and less. I'm saying the opposite. Hillel, more and more engage the ego. Another candle, another candle, another candle. We're going towards more, and Shammai says the goal is not more, the goal is less. Diminish as we get closer and closer to the heavenly source and dissolve the ego and all sense of separation and merge with the infinite. They have a similar argument, consistently expressive of these two divergent worldviews, if you like. Or what's the purpose of creation? Again, just to go back where the heaven comes first, I didn't fully spell it out. So Shammai says first heaven and then earth, because the objective is heaven. We're put down here to surrender the world and dissolve it, unite it with heaven. And Shammai, Hillel says, no, earth is created first and then heaven, meaning to say the objective is earth. What serves what? Shammai says that earth serves heaven, and Hillel says heaven serves earth. That's the argument. What comes first, meaning what's the final objective? What serves what? Shammai says heaven first, then earth, because heaven's the objective. Hillel says earth first, then heaven. The objective is this world, the body. Is the body to surrender to the soul, or is it about the soul engaging the body? Again, eating like a Jew or fasting, which is the quintessential moment? Denying self or using self in the service of God? Going beyond or within? Using different language for the same two very different views, and both, of course, are true. There's Yom Kippur and there's Purim, to start with. There's Shabbos and the weekday. Shabbos we transcend. That's a Shammai moment. Hillel we engage. I mean, weekday we engage the world. Tikkun Olam, fix it, be part of the world, go out there. That's Hillel. So that's their argument, the deeper argument in how you view, how we light the menorah in level number three. Are we adding in the world? Suffusing, engaging. All the whole objective is surrender. Till the whole world is completely nullified in one. Like a flame. You take a flame and put it next to a big torch. Disappears, becomes absorbed within the torch. Similar argument is a fascinating argument on the surface. It seems very strange, but now you'll understand it. They debate whether it's better man should be born or not. Is it better to have been born or not been born? So Shammai says, better not to have been born. And Hillel says, better to have been born. Again, what are they arguing? How could Shammai possibly say better not to have been born? God says you have to have children and populate the world. This all comes down to the world. That's God's mission. What does Shammai mean, better not to have been born? What are they arguing about? It sounds, on the surface, incomprehensible. But now you understand the depth of their argument. Shammai is saying, of course we're born by divine design, but what's the goal? The goal is to go back to the not. The big news is, here you are in a body. You could be distracted by the sensual and by the physical, and you're not. You live an angelic, otherworldly life. Better not to have been born means the whole objective is to go back to the pre-birth state, even though you are tethered to the body. That's a huge achievement. And Hillel says, no. The objective of the soul, better to be born, means eat, engage the body, not transcend it, use it. Food, drink, sensuality, possessions, money, use it all in the service of God. Permeate it. Permeate it with holiness. Not dissolve it. Don't surrender it. Permeate it. That's the depth of their argument. But the ruling is like Hillel. Because the ultimate objective, at least now, before Mashiach comes, Now the goal is not to disengage, but to engage. Like Hillel says, add in light. Another day, another day, another day. Don't cloister yourself in the world of holiness and transcend, which is the Shamai view, but be out there and engage and use all of the resources of the world, science, technology, everything the world has to offer, every experience. Use it to promote Yiddishkeit, to serve God, to reveal godliness, sanctify the world. That's the ruling, because that's the job now. And that's why in Chabad, we go to great pains and great effort to light the menorah on public government property and make it as public, as out there as possible. Bring the light to the furthest reaches of the world. Illuminate the darkest corners of the world. Illuminate, not dissolve it, not surrender it, but engage it. That's the ruling. That's the mission currently. When Mashiach will come, we'll be able to experience and understand Shammai's view simultaneously with Hillel, but that's not for now. It's an extremely deep idea. The two being not just in different stages or times, like Purim and Yom Kippur, but actually simultaneously. But I will be very satisfied if we've grasped these two views as we explained it now, in light of Hasidus and the Rebbe's writings. Interestingly, the word Chanukah, the very word Chanukah, the sages point out, the latter sages, stands for Ches Neiris Halacha Ke Beis Hillel, eight candles like Beis Hillel. Hinting to, in the very word Chanukah, to follow before Mashiach comes, at least in this stage of the world's history, we need to follow the Hillel view, because now it's about being out there. The practical engagement, bringing godliness down, not this way, this way. Not an austere life, not a life of disconnection, not a life of transcendence and disavowing the physical world and its resources and even experiences and pleasures. Engage them in a godly way.
Don't mean to interrupt. Tell me when I can ask a question.
Go ahead.
Are you sure? Actually, yeah. I have two. One is on the Hillel Shammai, the heaven down or the earth up,
yeah,
that concept, which is beautiful. Thank you, by the way. In my head, and I mean, it seems that both are correct, and I would use Jacob's ladder from the Torah as an example, where the angels are going up and down, and can't the angels going down be bringing heaven down to earth? And when they're going back up, they're bringing earth back up to heaven. So why can't they both be right?
They are. I said that all along. But the big news, what I'm saying is something actually in addition to what you're pointing out, which requires a whole different explanation. In the case of the angels, so the angel go, actually it's the same angels really, going up and coming down. What I'm saying is there's a third level where it's simultaneous. Going up and coming down, the same angel at the same time.
Okay,
that's a whole new level. How can you be doing two opposite things simultaneously? That's why I said that's a whole new level. But what you are right is, what you're correct in saying is that there is both. So there's Yom Kippur and there's Purim. There's Shabbos and the weekday.
Every day. They're equally important.
But the big news is that ultimately it's both simultaneously.
Cool.
So every day we do both, for example, not just Shabbos and Yom Tov, weekday. Every day you start off the day, you're not engaging the world. You pray, you daven. You know, it's before you eat, you have to say the prayers. That's a transcendent, ascending moment. Then you go out there in the world and you bring inspiration to and share it with the world. So there's this constant interplay between the two. But at different times,
Okay.
Overall,
Hillel is more important right now. You're saying
yes. Overall, that is why Shabbos is one day of the week, and the 6 days is Hillel.
Okay.
When Mashiach comes, it's described in our Bikat Hamazon. You say it every Shabbos. that we ask God to grant us the daily Yom Shekulo Shabbat. So then it's going to be Shamai. Actually, there's three stages in history. Now it's Hillel. When Mashiach comes, it's more the Shamai thing, transcendent, Yom Shekulo Shabbat. And then there's a third stage, Tchiyat HaMitim, post-Mashiach, where it's both simultaneously. And that requires a lot of...
Very deep.
How can you be both within and without, angel up, angel down, at the same time? Cool. Okay, that we'll leave that, but you're getting a sense of it.
I do.
You are quite right.
That was a great answer. And I just have one second question.
Please.
In terms of the Chanukah now, the Chanukah, the candles, the building on the joy, the Shamai Hillel Chanukah talk. I know we go by Hillel, but is now, you didn't talk about the lighting from left to right when you descend, like day, is that like a nod to Shamai that you get a little descent in there in the sense that you're starting with the current day and then you go down, you start with, let's say it's the third day, you do day three, then day two, day one when you light? Or like, why would that, how does that fit in? And maybe
that fits in, I'll tell you why, because it's consistent with Hillel. Right represents in Torah, holiness, revelation, chesed. Left is gevura, tzimtzum, contraction. We want to illuminate the darkness. So each night we're moving from, it's downwards. Holiness bringing it down to further and further reaches of darkness. So it's still consistent with Hillel.
Because left is gevura, so you're going left to right.
We want to illuminate more and more gevura, more and more concealment. Yeah.
No, less gevura then in theory. Oh, you're saying, no, but you're moving from left to right. If the left is the most gevura, then
we start on the right and we keep on adding towards the left.
But when you light, don't you light left to right, or am I doing it wrong though these years? When you light, don't you light the new day first?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought I'm sorry. I'm talking about how you add the candles.
Oh no, putting
you're
them
in, talking you're about put, you're talking light. About the actual lighting.
Yeah.
Yes. Let's think about this for a moment. You do light the first candle first. That may be
like Shamai,
as you say, and not the Shamai, because they're both holy views. They're both complementary, and so subtly, you know, each one, well, not so subtly, acknowledges the validity of the other one, so much so that at the end it's both simultaneously. So what you're saying is an interesting insight that, I mean, the simple answer is you light tonight's night first.
Right.
The first night we have to acknowledge, tonight's light three, third candle. But what you're saying, I think, is valid. It's also a nod to Shamai, which points to the integration and the harmony of the two, ultimately. Good point.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for sharing, Shana.
Thank you. Rabbi, also to confirm, when you set up the menorah, initially on day one, you start on the left and you continue towards the right. Or you start on the left, day one.
When you say start, are you talking about putting in the candles or lighting? What are you talking about?
The first day of Chanukah, when you put the candle in the menorah, facing the menorah, if you put it in on the left or the right?
The right.
The right. Okay, that's what I thought. Okay.
Yeah.
So you go right. Yeah. Okay.
It's your right, and you add to the left, but you light the first candle first.
Okay.
Yeah, the mosaic, in the mosaic which you received online, you can always refer to that for the details. Of how to light. And let me, while I have you, before we wrap up, for next Tuesday, I'm not here. Debbie, are you still on? Let's see. Yeah. Levy's here, so maybe Levy can do it if you want. Yeah, if you can talk to Levy, God willing, we'll be away. Amit Hashem, visiting the children.
Yay.
Well, yeah. So in the interim, I want to tell you like this, you should have received the email, and if you didn't, maybe I'll send it to Debbie and she can forward it to those of you not on our list for whatever reason. Lots of wonderful Hanukkah programs. Saturday night, 6:30, all on the Zoom channel. We can light the menorah together at 6:30, and there's latkes baking with Zeldi and a program for children. It's an hour program or less for the whole family. 6:30, Matzoi Shabbat. Trying to remember, Monday night, I'm lighting the menorah, the ice menorah at Hampstead Park. You can please watch that on Zoom. I forgot the time. It's pretty early, but you'll see it on the email. And then we also having a truck, a big truck going around Hampstead on, thank you, Valt, I forgot which day this is, I'm gonna tell you now.
Monday.
Huh?
Monday,
okay. And thank you. And with a electronic message and music and so on. And you can track the truck's movement on your phone by clicking on the link. And you come out there when it's outside your home and you get a fresh, free Chesky donut. How's that? So, Chabad, we're doing our best to make sure that the spirit of Hanukkah connects us all as much as possible as community. All right? So happy Hanukkah, everybody.
Happy Hanukkah, man. Rabbi. Safe travels.
Thank you.
Thank you for all
happy
you do.
Hanukkah.
Thank you to Debbie.